Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Elhamdülillah. Vessalatu vesselamu ala Rasulillah. My dear brothers and my sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. Today I'm going to spend some time with you again reporting about 43 widely spread hadiths that are not authentic, but they are well known to people and widely used by people. And I shall start by reminding myself and everyone that will listen to this hadith of mine that lying for or on behalf of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not permitted in under any circumstances, even if it is to make people like al-Islam. As Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, إِنَّ كَذِبًا عَلَيْهِ لَيْسَ كَكَذِبٍ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ فَمَنْ كَذِبَ عَلَيَّ مُتَعَمِّدًا فَلْيَتَبَوَّأْ مَقْعَدَهُ مِنَ النَّارِ Al-Bukhari and Muslim. So as I mentioned, reporting a hadith on behalf of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam without knowing the sources or the authenticity of the hadith is not permitted amongst the scholars of al-Islam. If you look in the books of a hadith, they always report the chain of narrators and before the scholars, it is well known between them that as soon as the person reports the chain of narrators, they do not need to say if the hadith was authentic or not, because they know the scholars who are going to study this hadith would know just by the chain of narrators. But today we live in a time where actually we don't have the knowledge of the chain of narrators and we rely on our scholars like Muslim, Bukhari and Sheikh Al-Albani, especially in our times, that qualify and classify the hadith either as authentic or as not authentic. As I said in my first part, that the hadith from its acceptance is divided into three parts. The sahih, and this is the authenticate, and the sahih is where the chain of narrators is true, and the meanings of the hadith or the wordings of the hadith are most likely that Rasulullah had spoken them with no guarantee that he did word by word, because so many hadiths have been reported to us by meanings only. When the hadith is hasan, it's a less degree than the authentic hadith, and it is also accepted as a source of evidence in al-Islam. The part three, or the third part, is al-hadith al-da'if. Al-hadith al-da'if is the class where everything that Rasulullah ﷺ didn't say is put in there. And in that sense there, if the hadith is not authentic, the scholars of Islam have set certain rules. First of all, is whenever we mention the hadith, we have to tell people that this hadith is weak. It's hadith al-da'if. And as long as there is no authentic hadith that we can use instead. If there is an authentic hadith, we must not report the weak hadith for leave it for the authentic one. This is number one. Number two, the condition number two that is also an agreement between the scholars of the hadith is that we cannot say that the Prophet ﷺ said it. We cannot utter when the hadith is weak. It is not permitted to attribute it to Rasulullah ﷺ, but we have to say it as they say, بصيغه التمريض. الصيغه التمريض المبني للمجهول. We have to say it in a passive form. It was said, it was reported, but we have no authority to say Rasulullah ﷺ mentioned. And number three, the condition number three is that we must not expect any reward at all from that weak hadith. So as you can tell here, it really defeats the purpose of mentioning the hadith or on acting on it. So let me start here and take a small journey with you for the next 43 hadith. I pray to Allah to help us go through. And please, please, please get your pens and papers and write down the hadith. If you speak Arabic, that's great. If you do not speak, pick the meaning and write it down, the meaning of the hadith, so that when you face it, you do not fall prey to it. Before I start with the first hadith, I want to say that the authority that I have used in this hadith or the research is of that Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah, with sometimes a supporting argument from Sheikh Ibn Baz alayhi rahmatullah, or before that al-Imam al-Dhahabi and the scholars of hadith like Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani and al-Imam al-Nawawi alayhi rahmatullah. So the first hadith is, من قرأ القرآن وحفظه أدخله الله الجنة وشفعه في عشرة من أهل بيته قلهم قد استوجب النار. As I mentioned, this hadith is reported by Ibn Majah and in the Mishkat al-Masabih, and this hadith is weak in the meaning of whoever reads al-Quran and memorizes it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Al-Qiyamah will enter him into Jannah, and he will let him intercede for 10 people from his household. All of these people deserved hell fire, meaning these people were going to go to hell fire, but because this person here memorized Al-Quran, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will let him intercede. And this hadith is extremely weak. This is why we see a lot of Muslims today, they themselves do not practice Islam properly. They don't read Quran, and they don't try to memorize it so that they can read it, but they invest all their time in what? Pumping their children to memorize it. Why? Because they have this hope, and that on the day of Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will let them off because of their children. But that is not going to happen. You have got to put some actions to deserve that intercession. It's not like you sleep and you don't do nothing and you expect the best out of it. Hadith number 2. And this is where it says, من أذن محتسبا سبع سنين كتب الله له براءة من النار. Whoever performs the adhan for 7 years without any taking wages or anything, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will write for him an innocence from hellfire, i.e. he will not enter hellfire. He is innocent from shirk or anything that leads to hellfire. This is a widely known and reported, as a matter of fact, somebody just told it to me yesterday. This hadith is not authentic at all, and we cannot attribute it to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani has reported in As-Silsila al-Da'ifa, that it is very weak. And as I said, when the hadith is weak, we don't have to act on it, we don't expect reward, and we cannot say that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said it. Hadith number 4. أيما امرأة ماتت وزوجها عنها راض دخلت الجنة رواه الترمذي والحاكم وأيضا موجود في رياض الصالحين. This text here says any woman that dies while her husband is pleased with her, she will enter al-Jannah. And this hadith or this saying here was reported in al-Tirmidhi and al-Hakim, but the hadith is weak, as Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani stated, and the hadith also is found in Riyad al-Salihin. And if you look at it, you will find that Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani has said it is weak. And again, it is any woman who dies while her husband is pleased with her, she will enter al-Jannah. This kind of a hadith is used a lot by men to patronize their women. And one of the ladies just told me, I think yesterday or the day before yesterday, that her husband said to her, if you do not allow me to marry a second wife and I commit fornication, all is in your neck. It's all in your account. And the lady is panicking and scared and all that kind of stuff. And again, that's the price we pay for being ignorant. Normally, these things, any woman should know by heart what her rights and what her husband rights when it comes to this kind of particular things. And number 5. ما استفاد المؤمن بعد تقوى الله خيرا له من زوجة صالحة إن أمرها أطاعته وإن نظر إليها سرته وإن أقسم عليها أبرته وإن غاب عنها نصحته في نفسها وماله. Again, this hadith here is that a man would not gain anything better after the belief and the piety of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala better than a woman, a pious woman, who when he commands her, she obeys him. And when he looks at her, she pleases him. And if he swears on her to do something, she does it. And if he is absent from her, she protects his honor and his wealth. And this hadith also is not authentic. It's very weak. And it is reported in Sunan Ibn Majah. But Al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah has disqualified it from being an authentic hadith. So again, this is another hadith that is being used widely there. Number 6. اقرأوها عند موتاكم يعني ياسين. Read Yasin when people are about to die. And this hadith is reported, or this saying here is reported by Imam Ahmad, والطيارسي وأبو داود وابن ماجة والنسائي وابن حبان والبيهقي والبغاوي والطبري والحاكم. This is a great chain of narrators, of scholars of hadith, but the hadith is weak. And as I said earlier on, if you remember, The number of people reporting a hadith does not make it authentic. It just makes it that the scholars, when they report it with the chain of narrators. It does, they are not saying it is authentic. They are just saying, this is what we heard and this is what we're saying. But as soon as we know that the hadith is weak, we must stop from using it. Number 7. أمرنا رسول الله أن نقرأ على الجنازة بفاتحة الكتاب. The meaning of this text in Arabic is that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم has ordered and commanded الصحابة, i.e. also us as well, to read on a janaza الفاتحة. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم. This is why you see a lot of people in Egypt worldwide, every time they say one word, two words, الفاتحة, and they start reciting it. That hadith is again in Ibn Majah, but the hadith is very weak and it does not relate to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Number 8. من أفطر يوما من رمضان من غير رخصة لم يجزه صيام الدهر. Whoever eats in Ramadan without any permission will not make up for that day, even if he fasted for eternity. And this hadith again is reported by Abu Dawood and Ibn Majah, and the hadith is weak, because in Islam, alhamdulillah, we have something called repentance. Once we repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever happened in Ramadan goes with Ramadan. So when Allah, if somebody, for example, disobeys Allah, eats in Ramadan, and then they repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, A, they don't have to make up for the day they ate. All they need is repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do other actions that are good and move on. Number 9. We all know that our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was married to a more than a woman. And we all know that his favorite was our mother Aisha radiallahu anha. And also here in Sunan Abi Dawood, it is reported on the authority of our mother Aisha radiallahu anha that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say, Allahumma hatha fi'li fima amluk, fala talumni fima tamluk, wala amluk. Meaning, Ya Allah, this is what I can do in that which I possess, so do not blame me for that which you possess and I do not possess. And that is meaning that I love Aisha more than the others. Please, Ya Allah, do not blame me for doing that. And this hadith also is not authentic and it cannot be used as an evidence for what it stands there. Number 10. أبغض الحلال إلى الله الطلاق. And this hadith again is reported by Abu Dawood and Ibn Majah. The most despicable and despised acts of halal in the sight of Allah is divorce. Or as the other hadith that says, like the throne of Allah shook or shakes every time a divorce happens, all these hadith are lies and they don't stand at all. For whatever is halal, it is halal to Allah. There is not something called 1% halal, 99% haram, and there is nothing something called 1% haram, 99% halal. When it's halal, it's 100% halal. When it's haram, it's 100% haram. Number 11, at the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is reported that our mother Aisha radiallahu anha says, رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو بالموت عنده قدح فيه ماء وهو يدخل يده في القدح ثم يمسح وجهه بالماء ثم يقول اللهم أعني على غمرات الموت أو سكرات الموت. And this hadith is reported in At-Tirmidhi and in Riyad al-Salihin that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, this is our mother Aisha saying this, that at the time of death Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم had some water, a jug of water just by his side, and he would put his hands in that water and then put it on his forehead, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help him on the death bed, whatever he's feeling. Sakarat al-maut is those feelings that we get at the time of death. And this hadith also is not authentic. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not suffer in his death as it is reported, but he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was making dua, Allahumma arhamni wa arhaqni bil rafiq al-a'la. Ya Allah, arhamni, have rahmah on me and join me to you in the highest level of al-jannah. This is why some people, when somebody is going to die, they give them water to drink, or they start putting water on them, and all of them based on this, wal-iyadu billah, very weak hadith. Number 12, and this is apparent in a lot of things that we Muslims do, we always start with alhamdulillah, and that's because it's based on this very weak hadith here, where it says, كُلُّ أَمْرٍ ذِي بَالٍ لَا يُبْدَأُ فِيهِ بِالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ فَهُوَ أَقْطَعُ. any matter that is of importance where people do not start with saying Alhamdulillah, that act there is cut. There is no reward in it. That's why you see a lot of people, they always start Bismillah, Alhamdulillah, and all these things, they praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, if you do it as you mean to say good things about Allah, by all means go and do it. But do not believe that you have to say it every time you give a talk, every time you give a Jum'ah, and all these things. It doesn't matter to do it or not. It's good to do them, but there is nothing wrong in not doing that. Again, this is by Sheikh Al-Arbani alayhi rahmatullah, and before him other scholars of Al-Hadith like Imam Al-Dhabi, Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani, and so on and so forth. One of the sisters sent me today a clip about some sheikh that was talking about al-hasad, the envy. And there is some envy mongering here. The people are, Muslims are really paranoid and schizophrenically, terminally distressed about this hasad and magic and all these things and evil eye. So much so that we don't do too much things because we are scared of the eye. And obviously, as I said, any Muslim that fears the eye or the evil eye and thinks that it is there to harm you, all that kind of stuff, actually it eats in their shirk. Evil eye is true. Envy is true. Magic is true. But it must not stop us from doing the good. So this sheikh here was scaring people that you shouldn't do this, and people are kind of like, the envy, my brothers and my sisters, I will make a talk about it, because a lot of people do not understand, they don't even understand the meaning of the word hasad, and why Allah has chosen the word hasan and not, for example, al-ayn darra, the harmful eye. Why? We'll do a talk like that on as-sabr, so that you understand that there is a lot of ignorance, a huge ignorance. Somebody calls me today after I did my pep talk about the charlatans of those who make the ruqya. He told me he went to this gentleman here, and straight away he lay him down on this massage table or some kind of like that. He had to pay the £50 a head, and then the other guy started reciting Qul Huwallahu Ahad on him. And this is really mind-crazingly boggling, and it's strange how low Muslims have gone. But anyway, this man here mentioned three evidences to insult Yusuf alayhi salam, which do not pertain to al-hasad. And he still said this is what the scholars of Islam says, but that is not what Yaqub alayhi salam says. And he mentioned, more importantly, a hadith, and that hadith is not authentic at all. He says, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالْحَسَدُ فَإِنَّ الْحَسَدَ يَأْكُلُ الْحَسَنَاتِ كَمَا تَأْكُلُ النَّارُ الْحَطَبُ وَفِي رِوَيَةٍ الْعُشُبُ. He says, well, in the claim that Rasulullah said it, that إِيَّاكُمْ وَالْحَسَدُ, be very careful and mindful of envy, for envy eats the hasanat, the good deeds, just like fire eats the wood, and in another narration, the dry herb. This hadith here, again, is reported in Sunan Abu Dawud and in Riyad al-Salihin. However, the hadith is not authentic, and as such, we should not pay too much attention to this saying here. Number 14, we Muslims are used to, whenever we have difficulties, nobody's going to tell you, do a business plan, see, do a to-do list, think well and plan your job and do all these things. Bring in as much success into your thinking, brainstorming, so that you succeed. All of us, they tell you, Istighfar, make istighfar. And then every time they tell you the story, I'm poor. And they tell you the narration of Imam al-Hasan al-Basri. When this gentleman came to him and he said, my land is about to die, he said, make istighfar. The other one says, I'm wanting babies. He goes, make istighfar. The other one doesn't have money, make istighfar. And this narration is one story reported by so many different people of knowledge, until Muslims today have become extremely lazy people. And they think that they're going to get successful by just making istighfar, and they rely on another hadith that is also unauthentic. That is the hadith, مَنْ لَزِمَ الْإِسْتِغْفَارِ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لَهُ مِنْ كُلِّ ضِيقٍ مَخْرَجًا وَمِنْ كُلِّ هَمٍ فَرَجًا وَرَزَقَهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. Whoever keeps tight to making istighfar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make for him min kulli dhiqin makhraja, from each narrowness in their life, hard times and difficulties, Allah will make him, or give him an exit from that. Wa min kulli hammin farajan, from every stress and distress, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open the gates of happiness and less stress. Wa razaqahu min haythu la yahtasib, and Allah will give him rizq from that where he was not expecting. And this hadith is again reported in Riyadu Sarihin and Sheikh Al-Albani عليه رحمة الله, and so other scholars like Ibn Taymiyyah عليه رحمة الله من have classified this hadith as weak. If you want your change and if you want your life to become better, get off your butt and go out there and work. Just work and rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But don't sit home and just subhanallah, astaghfirullah, 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 and then ask yourself why nothing is happening. It's because there is no evidence to support your argument. Even the arguments that are used in the Quran, the people, again, they take from them what they want to listen to, what they want to believe in, not what Allah says. And this is a huge problem that is happening today. And I will deal again one day with al-istighfar, just like I dealt with al-sabr. Number 15, and this happens a lot in the masajid when you go to a salat. Perhaps you've seen this. Some people, when the adhan is being, or the iqama is being made, the person wouldn't bulge until the muadhin says, قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ, and people would stand up. And in the adhan also, or do you hear people saying, أَقَامَهَا اللَّهُ وَأَدَامَهَا. And this hadith is fabricated. It does not stand. It's not authentic at all that the salat has been established. And أَقَامَهَا اللَّهُ وَأَدَامَهَا, especially the Arabs, they know this hadith here. Ibn Taymiyyah, Sheikh Al-Albani, and before them have qualified this hadith as unauthentic. Number 16, this is again a widely used hadith, and that is claimed that Rasulullah says, Al-kayyisu man dana nafsah, وعامل لما بعد الموت والعاجز من أتبع نفسه هواها وتمنى على الله. Here Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, he says, the smart is the one who holds himself accountable to his deed, and he works to that which is about to come after death. And al-ajiz, the lazy person, the inept and the incapable person, is the one who follows his own nafs, and he follows his own desires, and he just relies upon Allah. He hopes on Allah. This hadith again is da'if, and it's reported by Ibn Majah, and Shaykh Al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah has classified it as unauthentic. Number 17, widely spread in the Muslim or the Arab world, Sayyidul Qawmi Khadimuhum. And this hadith is unauthentic, لا يصح نهائيا. In fact, ليس له وجود في كتب السنة ولا المسانيد. This book doesn't exist anywhere in the books of a hadith or any books. It's not even a hadith, Sayyidul Qawm. And what it means really is the master or the leader of the people is the one who serves them. This is not authentic. Another hadith, and that is number 18, لا سلام على طعام, أو لا سلام على أكل. This is, you shouldn't mention السلام عليكم when people are eating. This is not even a hadith. This is just a regular Arab thing like that. So it's not even, or you can't even say it's a weak or not even a fabricated. It doesn't exist at all. Number 19, it looks like the Arabs or the Muslims today are looking for any validation, especially when it comes to the Arabic. You hear it a lot that people say that if you speak Arabic, you are an Arab. This is not true at all. Ya ayyuhan nas, inna ar-rabb wahid wal abu wahid wa laysat al-lugha al-arabiyya min ahadikum bi ummin wala abin wa innama hiya al-lisan. فَمَنْ تَكَلَّمَ الْعَرَبِيَّةَ فَهُوَ عَرَبِيٌّ رَوَاهُ إِبْنُ عَسَاكِرٍ. And this hadith is unauthentic, it doesn't exist also. What Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is supposed to have said, but it's not true. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ, people, the Lord, يعني the Rabb is one, Allah is one. وَالْأَبْ وَحْدٌ, and the father, there is only one father for each child. And the Arabic language is not from anyone as a mother or a father, meaning nobody owns it. وَإِنَّمَا هِيَ اللِّسَانِ, but it is the tongue. فَمَنْ تَكَلَّمَ الْعَرَبِيَّ, whoever speaks Arabic, فَهُوَ عَرَبِي, he is an Arab, and this is absolutely not true. Because if we say this about Arabic, it's also true about any other language. And if people speak six languages, which country they are from? But anyway, the hadith is unauthentic and it does not exist at all. Number 20, widely spread also in the Arab world and as an expression amongst every other Muslim, al-hasudu la yasud. The hasud is the one who envies, never will he have the upper hand and never be a responsible or master or something like that. This is not a hadith whatsoever. And the meaning also does not stand at all. Number 21, and I personally have read a research paper on this hadith here where they were trying to prove that al-Islam speaks the truth, as if we are still in doubt today. Anything that is discovered, they will say, the world has found this, and Islam has spoken about it 1400 years ago. It means thus 1 plus 1 equals 2. It means that al-Islam is authentic. And we don't know how much damage we are doing to ourselves, but this is a topic for another day. This hadith here is, نَحْنُ قَوْمٌ لَا نَأْكُلُ حَتَّى نَجُوعُ وَإِذَا أَكَلْنَا لَا نَشْبِعُ. نَحْنُ قَوْمٌ لَا نَأْكُلُ حَتَّى نَجُوعُ وَإِذَا أَكَلْنَا لَا نَشْبِعُ. And this hadith, Ali Rahmatullah al-Albani says, this hadith has no authentic evidence origin at all. And as such, we cannot use it at all. We people, we do not eat until we are hungry. And when we are hungry, we eat, but we never get full. This is not a hadith, not the meaning, nothing. It's not even a hadith, as Sheikh Nasruddin Albani, alayhi rahmatullah. And it doesn't, this saying here does not have an existence in any books of a hadith all over town. You look everywhere, you never find it. What it is somebody reported the story that when Maria al-Qibtiyya from Egypt was gifted as a gift to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a doctor was sent with her to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when the doctor saw, like a personal doctor by the king of Egypt, and when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam inquired about why the doctor was sent, he said, because he will take care of you. And they said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them, نَحْنُ قَوْمْ أُمَّةُ لَا نَأْكُلْ, until the end of this hadith here, but the whole story doesn't stand. Rasulullah didn't receive a doctor, and Rasulullah certainly never spoke these words here. Hadith number 22, and it is also widely, and you will hear a lot of people saying it, is that if somebody sits in the middle of a halaqa, a circle where we are sitting, people will pull him away and tell him, don't sit in the middle, because there is a curse on whoever sits in the middle of a halaqa. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, la'ana man jalasa wasat al-halaqa. And this hadith is in Abu Dawood, and this hadith is not authentic at all. You can sit wherever you want to. Number 23, حسن السؤال نصف العلم. A good question is half of knowledge, and this is a fabricated hadith altogether. Number 24 is a hadith reported by Imam Ahmad, where it says, إِنَّ الْغَضَبْ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ وَإِنَّ الشَّيْطَانِ خُلِقَ مِنَ النَّارِ وَإِنَّمَا تُطْفِئُ النَّارِ بِالْمَاءِ فَإِذَا غَضِبَ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيَتَوَضَّعُ. Al-ghadab, anger, is from الشَّيْطَانِ, and الشَّيْطَانِ is created from fire. And what extinguishes fire is water. So when one of you is angry, let him make wudu. This hadith also is extremely weak, and we cannot put it into practice. Number 25, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى قَسَمَ بَيْنَكُمْ أَخْلَاقَكُمْ كَمَا قَسَمَ بَيْنَكُمْ أَرْزَاقَكُمْ وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يُعْطِي الدُّنْيَا مَنْ يُحِبُّ وَمَنْ لَا يُحِبُّ وَلَا يُعْطِي الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَنْ أَحَبُّ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has divided between you your characters, your morals, your behavior, just like He divided your rizq in between yourselves. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives dunya to who He likes and He doesn't like, but He only gives the religion to those He likes. This hadith also is not authentic. It's not authentic at all. And this is reported in Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, but it is an unauthentic hadith. Hadith number 26, Al-anatu min Allah wal-ajala min al-shaytan. This hadith is in Sunan al-Tirmidhi. This is also a weak, very weak hadith. Slowness, taking it easy, is from Allah, and fastness and hastiness is from a shaytan. And this is widely in Arabs. If you want to tell somebody, let's do this quickly, then no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves when things are done slowly, and when you go fast, it's from a shaytan. And this is, again, as I said, is not a hadith, and we cannot apply it to our religion nor to our lives. Hadith number 27, afatul ilm an-nisyan. The calamity of the ilm, the knowledge, is that you forget it. This is also not a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this is in Al-Jami' Al-Saghir wa Ziyada, Imam Al-Mundhiri. Number 28, أجرأكم على الفتية أجرأكم على النار. Those who are fast to give fatwa are those who are fast to enter hellfire. And this is reported by Imam al-Darimi. And this hadith is very weak indeed by Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah. We all know that Al-Imam al-Nawawi has wrote his 40 hadith of Al-Imam al-Nawawi. He's not the only one. Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak and many other scholars of Al-Islam have written a book where they only compile 40 hadith. So why did they do that? It's because there is a hadith reported by Ibn al-Jawzi and al-Nawawi and Daraqutni wa Samhudi, and this hadith here is unauthentic, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is supposed to have said, "Man hafiza ala ummati 40 hadithan yantafi'una biha, ba'athahu Allahu yawm al-qiyamati faqihan 'alima." Whoever writes or safeguards for my ummah 40 ahadith, that the Muslims will benefit out of them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect them on the day of Al-Qiyamah, a scholar and a comprehensive faqih scholar. This is why Imam al-Nawawi wrote his 40 ahadith, but that is not an authentic hadith, so do not do it. Number 30, Al-Hikmatu Dallatu al-Mu'min, Haythuma wajadaha fahuwa ahakku biha. Daif jiddan, and this is in Ibn Majah. The wisdom is the researched and the searched of a believer, i.e. it's something that he always is after. So wherever he finds it, he is the one who takes it more than the other ones. He is the one who's got priority over it. Al-hikmatu dalatu al-mu'min, haythuma wajadaha, fahuwa ahaqqu biha. For this hadith here is unauthentic. Number 31, faqihun wahid ashaddu ala shaytan min alfi abid. One scholar and one understanding person is far more difficult on ash-shaytan than 1,000 worshipper. And this hadith here is fabricated altogether, and it is in Sunan Ibn Majah. Number 32, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is supposed to have said, "Ulama ummati ka anbiya'i bani Israel." The scholars of my ummah are just like the prophets of the children of Israel. And this hadith is unauthentic at all. La yasih. And At-Tirmidhi wa Zarkashi ibn Hajar says that it doesn't have any roots at all. And so did Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah. Another evil hadith that is widely spread amongst people, and that is number 33, "Man qallada 'aliman laqiya Allah saliman." Whoever copies a scholar will face Allah safe. Meaning, as long as you follow a scholar, any scholar, you are safe from the punishment of Allah, because on the day of Qiyamah, you would have followed a scholar. And this hadith, la asla lahu, and it is not even a hadith. And for your information, we are, by law, by the Islamic law, all of us, under the oath to seek knowledge. We cannot stick to one scholar or one group of scholars, and that's that. Between us and the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there are 1,438 years. 1,438 years. All these scholars in between are being neglected today, and Islam is not only who the sheikh of one sheikh today says, but in fact is thousands upon thousands alayhim rahmatullah. So we have to pay attention to that. When it comes to dua, we all would love that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to our dua. And in this hadith here, number 34, we are being told that إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يُحِبُّ الْمُلْحِينَ فِي الدُّعَى. Allah loves those persistent and insistent in a dua. You keep making the same dua over and 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 over. But in fact, this hadith is mawdu'a, is a fabricated hadith, and it is in al-Tabarani, and al-Uqayli fi al-Du'afa al-Kabir also qualified it as a fabricated, and it is in al-Da'if, al-Jam' al-Saghir, the da'if part of it. But the authentic hadith that is in Muslim, Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا دعا دعا ثلاثا وإذا سأل سأل ثلاثا. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, as in Muslim, used to, when he makes dua, he makes it in three times. For example, if you are in your sujood and you need something, you need your son to be cured from a sickness, so you make the dua, Ya Allah, cure my child. Ya Allah, cure my child. Ya Allah, cure my child. And if you ask Allah for something, Ya Allah, for example, you want to get married, Ya Allah, give me a spouse. Ya Allah, give me a spouse. Ya Allah, give me a spouse. Three times is more than enough. You don't need to keep repeating. So here, the number 34, Inna Allah Teala yuhibbul mulhin fi dua, innehu mevdu'. It's a fabricated hadith altogether. Hadith number 35, ad-du'a silahul mu'min. And in another version, al-wudu' silahul mu'min. Both of which are unauthentic. And this is by Al-Hakim and Abu Ya'la wal-Munziri. Fi al-targhib wa tarhib. And this hadith qualified by Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani as a very weak hadith. Number 36, إِذَا أَحَبَّ اللَّهُ عَبْدًا إِبْتَلَاهُ لِيَسْمَعَ تَضَرُّعَهُ. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves a person, Allah will send him a trial upon a trial, ibtila after ibtila, problems after problems, so that this person cries and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves hearing the cry of this person. And this is, waliyadu billah, an extremely, extremely weak hadith, and it is unauthentic. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not excruciate us and put us through these headaches so that he hears our voices. This is not the Allah that is the true Allah. But unfortunately, due to the spread of this kind of a hadith, people do have a very wrong idea about who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Number 37, أكثر ذكر الله حتى يقول مجنون. And this hadith is reported by Imam Ahmad and Ibn Hibban and Al-Tabarani and Al-Hakim, where it says, make the dhikr of Allah. And I want to take a second here to speak about the dhikr. A lot of people call the dhikr of Allah as remembrance. And as I said once, that is not the translation of the term dhikr. But the dhikr of Allah is to mention, because also I can say, اذكرني عند فلان, meaning mention my name with fulan. So dhikr Allah here, what it means is to mention the name of Allah. Avoid at all costs saying, remembering Allah, because you don't forget Allah. You mention the name of Allah. But in any case, here it says, أكثر ذكر الله, increase and say the ذكر of Allah abundantly, until people, when they see you, they say you're a crazy person. Hadith number 38 might surprise you. مفتاح الجنة شهادة أن لا إله إلا الله. The keys to Al-Jannah is لا إله إلا الله. This is reported by Al-Bazzar, and this is a hadith ضعيف. Always remember, any act that tells you you enter Jannah, you go to Jannah, must always be understood that nobody enters Jannah with their actions. It's not by reciting the Quran, it's not by doing this, and it's not by doing that, that you will enter Jannah. All our actions do is to make us eligible to enter Jannah by the mercy of Allah. Then when you enter Jannah, your rewards will depend on the actions you have done here. So here, مفتاح الجنة شهادة لا إله إلا الله is in fact untrue, because the keys to Jannah is the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number 39, everybody wants to get married to Hur al-Ain of us gentlemen. And for you ladies, you are going to end up with us men in Jannah. And remember the hadith in Sahih Muslim, every man will have two wives. And this is why there is a fabricated hadith reported by Ad-Daylami alayhi rahmatullah, which encourages Muslims men to go crazy about cleaning the houses of Allah, where it says, كنس المساجد مهور الحور العين. When you clean the masajid, the houses of Allah, that's the dowry you present for the ladies in Jannah. And I've heard a lot of people saying it. In fact, there is nothing of that. This is only you getting an extra reward, but ain't no dowry at all. Because in Al-Jannah, the relationship with there is a marriage, but there are no pre-requirements as there are on earth here, where you have to pay a dowry and all that kind of stuff. The hadith number 40 here is also a widely spread hadith, and it's reported in At-Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah wal-Bayhaqi and many other scholars of the hadith, and the hadith also is very weak. أوقد على النار ألف سنة حتى حمرت ثم أوقد عليها ألف سنة حتى بيضت ثم أوقد عليها ألف سنة حتى سودت فهي سوداء مظلمة كالليل المظلم. The fire has been set, and I'm talking about hellfire, for 1,000 years until it became red. Then it was again set until for another 1,000 years until it became white, and then another 1,000 years until it became extremely dark and black, and it is very dark in there, like the darkest of the nights. And this hadith, as I said, is extremely weak and it doesn't exist. Jahannam wa ya'adhu billah, I pray to Allah to safeguard us from it. Doesn't need all these years to do that. It's just a matter of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from it. And what it matters is just we don't end up there. Another hadith that makes man go daydreaming and all that kind of stuff, reported by Ibn Abi Dunya. And unfortunately, this hadith doesn't stand at all. Well, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is supposed to have said, لو أن حوراء بزقت في بحر لعذب ذلك البحر من عذوبة ريقها. If one of the Hur al-Ayn spat in the oceans would become extremely sweet because of the sweetness of her saliva. Well, sorry to disappoint you, my brothers, but ain't gonna happen. It's not gonna happen. The oceans will always be the oceans. So you better seek other hadith about that matter. Number 42 and the last one is a widely used and widely spread hadith that a lot of people, especially in the West, that want, and those people that want to push the meaning of Islam as peace down the throat of anyone that cares to listen to them. And that is when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered Mecca and the people of Quraysh came out and they were kind of like surrendered. Okay, you do with us what you want to do. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked them, مَا أَنْتُمْ ظَنِّنَا إِنِّي فَاعِلٌ بِكُمْ. What do you think am I going to do with you? They say, أَخٌ رَحِيمٌ إِبْنَ أَخٍ رَحِيمٌ. You are a merciful brother, son of merciful family, you're a good man, and things like that. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to them, اِذْهَبُوا فَأَنْتُمُ الطُّلَقَى. Go, you are the freed ones. Unfortunately, this is not authentic. This whole event didn't take place. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as I mentioned once, didn't tell them, go, for you are the freed. And a lot of people want to push this down the throat of the English or the American, that look what Quraysh did for Rasulullah for all this over 20 years on all they did. And when he had the upper hand, he set them free. Actually, that didn't happen. He didn't set them free. He had set certain conditions. Whoever enters the house of Abu Sufyan, whoever remains in their house, whoever doesn't come, whoever doesn't carry weapons, is safeguard and in peace with us. The majority of people didn't do that. There were a small minority who tried a little bit, and a few others have run away, and there were about 5 people that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had named them by names, and he said to the Sahaba, even if you find these people hanging on to the clothes of Al-Kaaba, to the thing, the garment of Al-Kaaba, kill them, kill them. And again, this is not the point here, but here, فَذْهَبُوا أَنْتُمُ الطَّلَقَى. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't say it, and as such, it's not authentic to use it as an evidence. Here, as you can see, 42 ahadith that are widely spread. Please, for the love of Allah, listen to this ahadith and spread them over. I've mentioned the names or the meanings in English. You can find them in an article or a whole article written around a hadith or something like that. If the hadith is weak, it makes the article weak. If the hadiths are authentic, it makes the hadith or the article authentic. This is why the book of Allah, the Quran, is the only book that is authentic from Alhamdulillah to Al-Jinnati wal-Nas. All that is in the Quran, but anything else is subjective to the science of the hadith. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us all and to make us aware again. Do not trust this knowledge to your memory. Write it down. Anything that you write down, you trust more. And remember, in the very first 5 ayat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed Al-Quran in the very first night, He says, Iqra, and then He mentioned Al-Qalam, the pen. If you write down, you learn. If you don't write down, you think you learn, but that is not true. Always remember, if you have to take your child whose life depends on the best doctor, who would you take your child to? To a doctor who studied at the university, wrote down his notes, or to a doctor who went just to the university and sat down listening only? Don't listen only. Study, study, study. This is your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. To join my group, just send me a message with your name, 078-76-408735, or send me an email at islampeptalk gmail.com and for your answer questions or anything else. وصلي اللهم على نبينا محمد سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.